Welcome to the second of our conversations on the situation, opportunities, and sometimes the challenges of openness. My name is Allan Behrens from Taxal. I suppose the first thing to talk about, just to remind those of you who've not seen the other episodes, what is openness? Well, openness means without obstruction, passage, or view. And to that end, what we want to do is talk to those in the industry who have experience and anecdotes to share with us on some of the topics of openness. And today we want to talk about openness within the ecosystem. So that's about accepting heterogeneity within our digital businesses. That's about connecting companies, ecosystems, and partners together. So let me introduce our guests. I have two guests today. I have Dan Primrose. Dan, hello.
Hi there. How are you, Alan? Yes, so my name is Dan Primrose. I'm the founder of a small engineering consultancy, Light Black Design, and we work on a range of different products from boats to plane parts to car parts, but generally just with a huge range of software, hardware, and just a different range of things.
Great. Thank you very much. Dan. So we've also got Ed Bernardon from Siemens. Hi, Ed.
Hey, Alan. Nice to be with you today.
Good. Ed, just a 1 minute on what you do and your sort of contacts with the openness environment.
I'm the VP of Strategic Automotive Initiatives at Digital Industry Software. And I get involved in a lot of cross-divisional projects, projects that not only cross divisions, but also that combine expertise within Siemens, even with our partners and our suppliers. And they can be on the mechanical side, the electrical side, and the ability to get all these different companies, all these different disciplines to work together is always a key part of all the projects that I get involved in.
Right. Thanks very much for that, Ed. So I suppose the question is, you know, what is open and is it a problem or an opportunity for yourselves? Dan, you know, what do you, when you think of open, what does it mean to you?
Well, we're really lucky. We work on like just a huge range of projects, and some, as I say, the automotive, aerospace, and just a different thing. So there's a huge level of a huge range of the sort of the opportunities that we get, and most of them are pretty much blank sheet of papers. Sometimes people come to us with existing products that are need optimizing, and we just really have to completely think of different ways of doing things. There's no set way. Two projects aren't the same. So we're really open, and I guess that's probably the sort of thing there, is that every project is completely different, and you have to really step back a bit, really look at all of the options that are available to you. They're not just we're using a range of materials or processes or software, and each one has its specific. We did generally a lot of the projects we do are based around composites, light weighting, and just making products more efficient. Whether it's lighter, more cost effective, more higher volumes. But either way, that they're all different, and we really have to be just completely open on where we start from and what we're going to be using and where we.
And I suppose one of the key attributes there, you know, when we're talking about openness, is the communication between yourselves and the OEM or even your suppliers. I mean, that's an area which obviously causes a lot of challenges.
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, for us, it's a massive thing. We work with a range of softwares and a range of OEMs and a range of tier ones and twos. Right from bits of paper, how we record it, you know, just from initial sketches, how we communicate back with the databases and things like that. We work with different softwares we use. You know, we've worked with Siemens very closely on a range of projects recently, and there's always different CAD systems, and that's always a, you know, it's an interesting problem. They generally don't talk to each other particularly well, so you have to really try and find, you know, clever ways of making sure that you're not losing out and getting old issues, and you know, everybody's up to date, and that's a big hurdle, but it's doable. It's absolutely doable.
And Ed, I mean, this whole thing about connecting customers, ecosystems, and all that, I mean, what's your experience in that?
Well, Dan brings up a good point, right? If the industry was stable and there weren't big changes occurring, which is not the case in automotive right now, there's just basic differences between the tools that different suppliers or different OEMs might use. So he has the challenges of being able to work on different CAD systems or whatever it might be. But as we all know, the automotive industry is undergoing major changes right now. So electric vehicles, autonomous vehicles, mobility as a service. And if you just look at one of the most basic pieces there, which is we're moving away from internal combustion engines and replacing probably one of the most complex pieces of equipment in a car with some wheel motors, say, batteries, and a lot of software. So the expertise that's been built up over the last 80 years or so designing internal combustion engine cars is suddenly has to be replaced. So what ends up happening is, where do you get that expertise? Some of it might be internal, but the mechanical group has to be able to work more easily now with the electrical group. Then you have suppliers that bring in expertise. They may be experts in motors or battery systems or whatever it might be. So you layer on top what Dan was pointing out in terms of the mix and matching of all the different types of tools. But now it becomes even more critical to have these types of conversations to build up this expertise for this new generation of automotive designs that's coming about because of all the major changes in the industry.
And just and to follow up on what Ed's saying there is that traditionally most OEMs, that the majority of the people there within a design office are probably body engineers, mechanical engineers, and interior, exterior designers. But actually, when you think of the newer OEMs, you know, they are beginning to become, you know, very, very powerful OEMs, particularly people like Tesla. I would probably, I'm guessing probably 70% of the people there are software based. And actually the car is a relatively simple bit that just gets added on at the end almost. You know, that's a slight generalization, but that's pretty much it. So it's a huge change.
Well, thanks very much. That's really interesting, actually. But I suppose the what people are going to be interested in is what needs improving in the openness within the ecosystem of your supply chain, Dan?
Well, I think as we've been talking about, the most important thing is that everybody is a lot of the software needs to be a lot more user friendly. I think it doesn't need to be, but it would really help if we can get these things. I think as Ed was talking about with the you know, we're also used to such really simple user interfaces with all of our software. And actually, a lot of the CAD and the databases is definitely coming on. And it's a mammoth thing to try and change. But if we can all be ready and willing to accept newer technologies and advances in how we do things, I think it can get a lot more fluid. And we can all be a lot more open with each other and where, you know, when we change things and stuff like that.
Yeah, I suppose there's a sort of a learning hurdle. I think we're going through a learning hurdle. Companies are, it isn't just different applications, it's different versions of different applications that have got to collaborate over this very complex network between different, you know, manufacturers, suppliers.
Yeah.
You know, that creates this complexity. So the simplicity is going to be a fundamental part of this, isn't it?
It's a huge thing. And you want to have competitiveness. You absolutely want every single CAD system and every single database system to be better than the next, better than the other one. And everybody wants their one to be the best. And so it's a really difficult one to get. Well, actually, ours, but we will be able to talk to the other one as well. So it's and you wouldn't want everybody to be owned by the same company and all doing the same thing, because we just lose all of that competitiveness between everybody, between all the systems. So it's a really tricky thing. And I'm pretty sure if I was a senior person like Ed within a massive corporation, I wouldn't want my system to be dulled down so that it would work with another system. So you've always got to be best, and we all want to have the best system, absolutely the best system. It's just really how you get them to talk to each other. There's a huge amount of software out there nowadays that does translate systems back and forth, and there are more and more of those coming up. So I'm guessing that when you look at all of those systems available now that weren't there a few years ago, that's a huge, people have realized that that's a huge market, a huge potential for us all to be able to talk to a lot more people seamlessly without wasting time and having to, you know, receive dumb models and, you know, re-engineer them. And that's a great opportunity if the if the actual CAD systems can adopt that same technology within them, then maybe that's a solution, and that would take away the business from all of those other little ones trying to get in.
So Ed, same question to you. What is it that you think needs improving in this, in the openness within the ecosystem, the supply chain ecosystem?
Well, it's certainly in the supply chain, but even within departments within a particular company, say the powertrain group, the body group, the electronics group, is the ability to understand some of the fundamental issues that the others are undergoing. So for instance, if you're a body engineer and you are constraining the battery box in an electric vehicle, say, to a smaller volume, are you making a mistake in terms of not giving them enough volume to package in the electronics or possibly to properly cool the battery system? And vice versa, by adding weight or volume to the battery box to get range, are you causing some sort of a problem so it no longer fits in the vehicle, or you can't satisfy stiffness or vibration? So what you really need to do, one of the big improvements, is you don't want the body engineers to have to become super experts in the area of powertrain engineering. However, it would be great if there were some simple tools on both sides of that fence, the electrical side, the powertrain side, and the body side, to allow you to do some of the higher level, more basic trade-offs. If you have a battery pack of this size, leave at least enough volume that you can get the cooling system in, or whatever it might be.
Great. Well, I very much appreciate both of your inputs. I'm sure the listeners will be fascinated by the conversation. Appreciate your time. Thank you very much, Ed and Dan.